My name is Francis Emukule, and I would love to warmly welcome you to the Homes and Construction Show today, and I don't want you to miss this particular episode. So join me as we catch up with Chris on this particular one. Chris, man, I've entered without with my shoes. The fact that I'm going to, out of respect for the players, you know. Thank you. Whew, this is a comfortable place. Chris, nice place to have here, man.
Well, we are at Chris's humble abode in Ports. This is a beautiful place to have here, Chris. And I would love to officially welcome to the Home Construction Show.
Thanks, man.
All right. So, guys, Chris, as I introduced you earlier on, is a very, seasoned expert in this business of Airbnb. And I want us to understand what it exactly means for one to start this business. That's one. And then also, if you intend to consume this business, what you need to know. But before we go there, Chris, I'd love you to, you know, in a brief, introduce yourself.
My name is Chris Pastiwanuka.
Okay.
On social media, I go by Chris Bona. Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, mm-hmm. everywhere, mm-hmm. go by Chris Bona. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing this since 2018. That is like 6 years now.
Whoa, I told my guys 2 years, so I was wrong.
No, it's actually 6 years. In fact, you're counting seven because the first year was a discovery year. That's when I discovered about the business. Then I started to educate myself, learning how the business works, reading articles, watching YouTube videos, and that was my 2017. Now 2018 is when I get hands-on. That's when I start.
So you took a whole year out?
Yeah, trying to
read.
Yeah, sure.
So which speaks to the fact that knowledge is key before you get into any business.
Yeah, of course, because if you don't know what you're going to do, you're already setting yourself up for failure.
Okay.
Yeah.
In a tidbit, what did it take for you to start to discover yourself? What did you do to discover yourself? Because being that you've done this business for about 6-7 years now, it means you actually understood what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It takes for you to do this business, and it's definitely working for you because you're there. So what did you see in this discovery journey?
Okay, look, Francis, like in any other business, I think knowledge, like we said, is very key.
Definitely.
So for me, the way how it started was in 2017. I'm an Uber driver. I picked this Zimbabwean lady from the airport. And during our trip, we talked about many things. So she's telling me, midway the trip, she's like, "You're taking me to my Airbnb in Tinder." I didn't even know how to pronounce the word Airbnb. Like, I have not had a place called Airbnb, whatever you have said.
You thought it was a place?
I thought it was a place, a destination or something. So this lady, Coco, I actually told Coco later in the years after I'd started the business and it's now trying to work for me. Like, "Coco, look, I'm going to mention your name everywhere my story will go." Anyway, back to the story. So Coco tells me, "Take me to my Airbnb in Tinder." I was very curious. I'm like, "What do you mean Airbnb?" So she begins to explain
to me
and tells me, actually, Airbnb is like Uber for houses.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when she said Uber for houses,
and yet you're in Uber for cars.
Yet I was in Uber for cars.
Mm-hmm.
I immediately understood what she was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And in my heart, I was like, "I think this is something I want to try out."
Okay.
So I take the entire 2017, reading every article, watching different people. But unfortunately, at the time, there was not a single content creator
in Uganda,
in the Airbnb space, for Uganda particularly. So I was watching content for people hosting in USA, hosting in Canada, hosting in UK. And I knew there was going to be a problem if I was going to start only based on the content I was consuming
from outside.
So I knew I needed practicals in Uganda
practical examples.
Exactly, practical work in Uganda. Mm. And so there was a friend of mine, I think around mid-2018, and this guy had two Airbnbs. So once he told me he did have, and then me myself, I was in the discovery process, trying to learn the business. I was like, look, mm-hmm. I'm going to offer you 1 year of free management for Airbnbs.
Oh, for your friend?
Yes, for my friend. Mm-hmm. And what I'm trying to do is to learn the business.
Get yourself into the experience and...
Exactly, hands-on now. Mm. So luckily enough, my friend actually agreed to the offer. He let me manage his Airbnbs, basically running the show, like from guest check-in to technical teams, coordinations and stuff, guest check-out, like basically everything. And I must confess to you, Francis, for me that was, I think, my golden year.
Man, I think if it were me, the moment I finish that, I'm getting my own business.
Exactly.
Because you're learning on job.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what it took you for the discovery. Yeah.
Exactly.
So now, after discovering mm-hmm. yourself and knowing exactly what you need to do, now you see, this show helps people understand what the trends in real estate, what you need to do to get into certain spaces of real estate. Now, I want to speak to someone out there that was like you, mm-hmm. that thought Airbnb is a place somewhere. Mm-hmm. But sometimes they even have the capability, they have the money, or they have the space, but they don't know what to do with it. Mm-hmm. What does it take for someone to get into this space of Airbnb, and what should they know, basically?
Okay, look, there is two ways to approach it.
Okay.
First, you can talk about somebody who has their property somewhere. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Their own property.
They own a property somewhere, and maybe they would like to explore that space and find out how this works. Mm-hmm. That's one way of approaching it. Mm-hmm. The other way is actually doing rental arbitrage. That's
rental?
Like arbitrage.
What's that?
That's like you rent space somewhere and then you set it up, furnish it well, put everything that needs to be put, mm-hmm. and then you put it out on Airbnb. Mm-hmm.
Okay, rent arbitrage. Okay.
Rental arbitrage. Mm-hmm. Yeah, then people start booking, and you get off your rent and keep the margin, something like that. That's of course, like any other business.
I hope you're listening. Oh. Okay. Uh-huh.
So yeah. So that's how basically you approach it. Mm-hmm. It's either you have a property or mm-hmm. you don't, but you're willing to rent, or you have the funds to rent.
Okay.
And that's it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So now I have a property. Mm-hmm. What do I need to put inside this property? Because now if I look at your place here. Mm. If I was told to sleep here hungry for 1 week, I would do it. Uh-huh. It's so nice.
Thank you.
What do I need to do? What do I need to put in my house? Hmm. And, or, do I... Because I want to believe that the product you offer, uh-huh. oftentimes reflects the clientele you're targeting.
That's correct, yeah.
What should you put in? Should you put a certain type of mindset in as far as the people you want to target is concerned, or mm-hmm. the general perspective of what exactly you need to put in your property to mm-hmm. hit the jackpot?
Well, what should I say? Because again, Francis, there is Airbnb, mm-hmm. it is like a niche, mm-hmm. real estate niche. Mm-hmm. But again, even in the niche, there is micro niches. Mm-hmm. So,
spoke about that earlier.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So, there is micro niches. Mm-hmm. So, it all comes down to the kind of market you're trying to target. There's somebody who is going to target the expatriates who come here to work. Somebody has gotten maybe a contract with one of the firms in Uganda, mm-hmm. and maybe it's a 2-year contract, and they're here to work. Mm-hmm. So that kind of person is going to stay for 2 years. Okay? So that means it's going to be different from a person who comes here for holiday.
Like for Christmas.
For Christmas holiday, the Ugandans who work abroad. Because what people don't understand is that most Ugandans actually who work abroad, when they come here, they don't want to go and sleep home.
Hey, Bewalaji.
I don't know, maybe privacy, but for their own reasons. I must tell you, most people we have actually, they will come spend like 3 weeks with you. And in the last week when they are now
they go to the
go
village.
Back home. We'll go to the village. They have different reasons. Kati, you know, micro niche where in one micro niche and the langa base specifically for safari tour. You know, for 2 weeks, that means you want to work. Ebintu byogenda okuteeka mu apartment y'omuntu aze for safari tour tebigenda fanagana na bintu byogenda teeka mu apartment ey'omuntu agenda okubeerawo omwaka mulamba because omwaka omulamba we assuming they are going to want to use the kitchen
masepichi
cooker, oven, toaster, microwave okitegeera
ebyonna bimuteera
exactly so olina okukifanishinga ekifo ng'omuntu your space is going
to be
livable or homey yeah.
Someone needs to feel home away from home.
Exactly. And also for that kind of niche, they have an Abazeba expatriates who have come to work. Because, again, you realize that most of them come with family. So you're going to need a bit more space.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Where you would put maybe a one bedroom for a holiday maker or somebody who comes for holiday, here you're going to put maybe 2 bedrooms or 3 bedrooms.
That's interesting.
That's where the difference comes in. And again, now for the people who come here for safari, they're not going to spend most of the time in Kampala. They are going to tourist destinations. So anything basic can work for them as long as it's secure, it has electricity, it's accessible.
Beds that are comfortable.
That's it. We're talking 2 days. And the rest of the days they're going to be out on safaris.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So, where, if you were in the shoes of one who is starting, where would you put your money more? Is it on the safaris or the other expatriates or these holiday makers?
Especially for somebody who is starting, I understand it's not so easy, but I would encourage they target the guys who do long stays, the expatriates. The reason is, you don't want to spend a lot of time looking for another person who is going to check in after this one has checked out. So you want to try and
a consistent
somebody consistent who is going to give you a consistent income flow. So you, because again, first of all, you are a newbie. You're still struggling with so many things, figuring this, figuring that. You don't want to add marketing on top of what you're trying to figure out.
So you want a one-off that's going to stay as you figure out other things.
Okay. As you learn on the job.
So, of course, every business has a risk.
Definitely, yeah.
Where are the risks in Airbnb? Because for me, I'm not seeing any risk because, I mean, now let's explore about the payment bit. How do these guys get paid? Do they pay... How do you get paid as a service provider? They pay you before or after?
Okay, so this is what happens. Though we say it is Airbnb, but generally it's the short-term rental space. Airbnb is just like one of the brokers or the platforms where we get clients.
Yeah, like there's Booking.com.
Some don't even work here. There is Booking.com, Turnkey, quite a number. But what happens usually... When somebody in the UK wants to come, we are in October, they want to come to Uganda and spend the entire December. They can make payment to the broker who is Airbnb now. Airbnb collects their money, okay? After it has collected their money, it will keep their money until December.
Then they release it to you.
They can disburse the money to me.
Oh, so that means they come. They pay before they get it.
They get to pay before they get it. In any case, me, I'm going to blame Airbnb. If I don't get my money, it is supposed to be Airbnb. And actually, Airbnb is insured. As long as you are a host, in case of anything, be it damage or what,
they pay.
Insurance.
So if I broke your TV, how do you get the money?
If you broke my TV, they either charge your card, or if you don't want them to charge your card, maybe you do shady stuff. Airbnb will get out of their pocket, and it's called air cover.
Because I had scenarios in Kenya where there was this service provider. She was complaining about a couple that had stayed in an Airbnb space for about a week.
Yeah.
But by the time they left, looked like a crawl. that sold her bed sheets. People had urinated all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
So, and she was complaining. In that instance, where do you lodge your complaint? Because they are gone. Oh, is there a situation where before someone leaves, you inspect?
Yeah. Yeah. What happens at checkout, you come in and inspect.
Okay.
And tell them, look, I gave you my place. It has a TV and it wasn't cracked. Here is my TV. I'm checking this car. Either they pay and you resolve it there and then, or you submit your claim to the resolution center, Airbnb.
Because I don't care what do come, what can I come and I leave in the morning.
Cheshimu, like, as long as you are itam Airbnb,
I'm charging
by the record, they will charge his card, but when the card is disconnecting, that's their problem. They will go in pocket and pay.
So this instance, because that's when you call someone Airbnb, they say that, you know, you, for example, on your property, you could list that you host two people or you or one person. You have space for two people or one person. And then the person ends up reporting with three people. How do you deal with that?
Now, that's entirely up to you. You can choose to let them in or stand firm with your house rules. You're like, you know what? For us, we don't do more than two people.
Or charge extra.
Or we charge you extra.
Mm.
That's also, it is something you put in your house rules.
Mm.
But in app, you can do all that.
Mm.
You can put your house rules and be like, we take in a minimum of two people. But in case you want to do extra people,
there's this fee.
There is this fee.
Mm.
So they either pay.
Or they bounce.
Or, yeah. Or it's a no-no. Yeah.
Well, now let's talk about the challenges that come with Airbnb. I remember, you know, actually, for guys that don't know, I interacted with this content on TikTok, and it was really very informative that I had to slide into his DMs and catch up with this young man. It's very interesting content on TikTok. Your handle is on TikTok?
Yeah, I'm Chris Bonner on TikTok.
Chris Bonner on TikTok. You can go there, and I believe you can also, it can guide you on how to start Airbnb business, or better still, as a consumer, you know, could also give you tidbits on how you need to go about it if you want to make this decision, because you have been a big player. So one of the videos that I saw on TikTok that you made was about a client that you hosted.
Mm-hmm.
And they overstayed, and then they convinced you to take them off the payment system of Airbnb.
Mm-hmm.
And later on, you say that they ran away with your money. Is that so?
Okay, that's correct, because I said it.
Mm-hmm.
What happened was, so we let this lady in. She was from Spain.
Mm-hmm.
She was from Spain, I think. So she comes with a boyfriend, and she's supposed to stay 2 weeks. Uh-huh. So 2 weeks elapsed, she's like, I want to extend more 2 weeks. We're like, cool, go ahead and extend.
Sasula.
Uh-huh. Nga sasula, kuita mo app.
Mm.
So she pays, even the 2 weeks elapsed, she's like, now look guys, every time I pay through Airbnb the app, I get charged, you get charged.
Is it should be that one?
Uh-huh. Why don't we just do, you know, I just transfer funds direct to you.
That lady might be a Ugandan somewhere in her.
Maybe.
Okay.
So she convinces us and we take her off app, and now she starts paying direct. First month, she pays well. Second month, she pays well. Third month, she really stayed for like 6 months actually.
Uganda woman.
So third month, she pays well. No. The third month now is where trouble comes in. She starts creating excuses.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, when you're in business, there is this side which is human.
Yeah, she has been here almost 5 months. Uh-huh. That's excusable.
We have kept this lady for some time. There is that rapport that has been, you know, created. We're like, okay, fine, that's okay. And so that entire month, she kept creating excuses, excuse upon excuse. Month goes down, she has not paid. Now, at the beginning of the second month, she's not picking calls, and it was lockdown time. Movement is hard. You know? Up until one time, I got a bike and rode to the location.
Yeah, what I say?
I know she was there. I'm like, hey, why, what's going on? You cut communication. Like, oh, by the way, I lost my phone, my boyfriend, blah, blah, blah. You know, stuff, stories. So I'm like, it's fine. Okay, now when are you sending the payment through? She's like, actually, give me up to next week. I'm going to process the payments online, you know. Now she gives me her new number. She has changed the new number. Mm. Now, on this new number, I keep talking, and she's responding. That week she had promised elapses, and trying to contact her again, she goes back to silent mode. And that is the time she used to actually vacate the house and disappear.
Right, I'm sorry to laugh, Nate.
Yeah. Welcome to Kampala. Yeah. Kampala.
Yeah. All right. Mm. So, man, so those are some of the risks that...
Those are some of the...
So, yeah, taking off... Taking, would it have been any different if she was on the app, on Airbnb?
It would be different.
How?
Airbnb has to pay.
Oh, so you made a loss.
Yeah.
So, never take off someone... the platform. They don't take the client off the Airbnb app because there then you're vulnerable.
Exactly.
And Airbnb is not responsible for anything that happens you.
This is business besides them.
This is business, Ugandan style.
Yes. Mm. Yeah.
Kati, you talked about the other arbitrarily, what?
Arbitrage.
Arbitrage.
Yeah.
And I've seen some people do that. I've seen some young people do it. But what are the ins and outs of doing business in that manner? Because I've rented a place, I've told the landlord, you know what, no one going to live here, and then we'd convert it, and the next time there's a white guy living there.
Mm-hmm.
How do you go about that?
Okay, look, one of the things I've had to learn a hard way is honesty, upfront.
Mm-hmm. Upfront. Landlord, Mugambira, auntie,
yes.
I'm renting.
Yeah.
Is this what you're for now on time? Mm-hmm.
There is a better way of packaging that information. Tell them, look, I'm going to be paying up front.
Pay them 6 months ahead.
If that's what you choose. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be paying you well. Also, I'm going to be renting, because of course the question always is going to be how safe, how secure is our property when you're bringing in strangers once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
The best way to package it would be like, look, we get these strangers from credible platforms which are insured.
Mm-hmm.
In case anything was to happen, your property is going to be, you know, you're going to be reimbursed in case of damage.
So honesty is first.
Honest has to be upfront. There is no other way.
But do you think it's also important to actually, you're right, it talks about the honest a bit.
Yeah,
I think that it's important to bring the landlord up to speed in as far as what you want to do.
You really
so that you don't have to cross line.
Exactly.
Because well there are also landlords out there that are funny. We see that you're making bank, you know. Hey, you tell you and they also put it into the same platform or do use it for something. So honesty is actually very important. One very important thing that we talked about earlier on is the niche that you talked about.
Yeah.
I talked about someone having a house in Namgongo, for example, or outside of Kampala. What are the chances that they may have business, Airbnb business, being that they are far away from town as opposed to those that are near, for example, in Bugolowi? What are the chances of them making the margin profit in as far as someone who is near town is concerned?
Okay, look, again, at the end of the day, what makes this business profitable is, first of all, referrals and repeat business.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have something that is located in a place that is really far from everything,
mm-hmm.
especially town, I don't know why, but for whatever reason, everybody wants to be close to town.
It's convenience.
Maybe convenience, mm-hmm. because most of the amenities, everything, CBD.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So that means you can get one-timers,
mm-hmm.
but they will never come back.
Mm,
simply distance. Because of the distance, inconvenience.
Mm.
But one-timers, because if somebody really is going to book from Manchester, they have not been to Uganda, so they don't even know. Because it's actually... when you get to think about it, it's not such a long distance from Kampala to Namgongo, but the state of our traffic jam.
And even the potholes.
All those factors put together, you know. So somebody is going to look at it from a point of, oh, okay, I'm in Manchester, it's not a long distance, so transport is going to be smooth. Mm-hmm. They're going to come and find something practically different on the ground. They'll never come back.
Bouncing castles on the road.
Mm-hmm. True.
Okay. Yeah. So there's going to be discomfort.
They will never come back. Mm. And that means you don't have repeat business. If you don't have repeat business, you can't entirely be on first timers.
Mm.
No, you can't thrive. You'll be surviving. You're going to keep in survival mode.
Mm, the way,
yeah.
That's interesting. So let's talk about you. Mm. Where are your properties located?
I have properties in Bugolori. First of all, it's like an entire portfolio of 28 units now.
28 units?
Yeah, around Kampala.
How do you do that?
What do you mean?
28 units.
I do this for a living. Like, it's what I'm doing every...
So your model is arbitrary?
Not really arbitrage, because what I do, there is arbitrage, yes. Mm-hmm. Some I arbitrage, but again, some I also manage for other people. Because for me, this is like what I do for a living. Mm. I house human beings for a living.
What so much?
That's what I'm doing.
No, what did you study?
What I did at school, well, between 2013 and 2015, I was in Makerere University trying to do BCom as a BComer.
Mm.
And I did it for 2 years. I felt like this was not for me. I walked out of university.
Mm.
Yeah.
You don't have a year, you know.
Yeah.
So you walked out of university, went into Uber business, and now got into Airbnb business. And now you're running 28 units.
Yeah, now it's 28 on the portfolio. We have Bugolobi, Ntinda, Chanja, Gaddafi Road, that is in Makerere. Different locations. For some locations you find, for example, in Makerere, there is 6 units on a block. Ntinda, you find there is 3 on a compound. So that's where the 28 comes in. It's not like 28 in different.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.